Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Body Beneath the Willows by Nick Louth, narrated by Marston York. Chapter 1. January 2020. Angela Blanchard was surprised to see her husband's car backing up the drive towards the house at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, while it was still light. The big white Volvo sporting the distinctive tangled blue and green arrows logo of his employer, Aqua Western Limited, rolled right up to the garage door. She put the kettle on. Normally, he wouldn't be home until 5, except on a Friday. But today was Tuesday. Usually, she would hear his cheerful whistling as he approached the door, the kicking off of the work boots in the porch if he'd been on site, greeting the cat, which rolled over on her back to have her tummy rubbed. And at the end of every week, the banging out of the car mats against the wall to get the mud off. It was a fixed routine. But today he came straight in wearing his boots, dumped his briefcase on the hall table, ignored Felix, who was meowing by the door, and clumped straight upstairs without saying hello. Most unlike him. She followed him, calling from the foot of the stairs. "Are you all right, Ozzy?" she called. Lumps of mud flecked the stair carpet. Angela made allowances. She was an understanding woman. He must be stressed about something. There were mumbled replies. He was fine, apparently. Clearly not true, but no doubt he'd tell her in his own time. As she waited, the rising roar of the electric kettle seemed to mark her husband's blood pressure. Ozzy was already bustling from his home office with a couple of big file folders and his laptop. She squeezed to one side on the stairs as he thundered down, arms loaded. "Do you want a cuppa?" she called after him.
"Fine for the moment, thanks."
He disappeared out to the garage for a few minutes. Angela heard the sound of the car boot slamming and then he hurried back inside.
"Ozzy, what's the matter? Do you have to go back to work?"
"There's been a bit of a flap on, a project crisis."
She assumed that meant yes.
"The Winchester to Havant Phase 2 again?"
She was proud to be able to hold up her side of abstruse water engineering conversations, learning the names and techniques, taking an interest, accommodating the technicalities. One time she had gone to lunch with Jill and given her a 5-minute overview of the ongoing problems with the narrow-bore deep-reach pump, whose failure to reach a technical spec on overcast days had been holding up WinHav 2, as it was known. Jill, who worked part-time with Angela at the local pharmacy, was impressed but baffled. Angela had her explanation.
"It's my job to help him get stuff off his chest."
She explained that it was one of the reasons for the success of their 27-year marriage. To listen and pretend to understand. Ozzy, now back upstairs, asked,
"Do you know where my old Thames water jacket is? I thought it was in the wardrobe in the spare bedroom."
"That old blue one? That's in the underbed storage in the spare room. I was thinking of chucking it out. It's not waterproof anymore, is it?"
"It's good enough."
He thundered back up the stairs, and she could hear the sounds of activity.
"Ozzy, why do you need that old coat now?"
There was a few seconds' silence.
"I said I'd lend it to a friend."
Angela was quite baffled by that. What kind of friend would need an old coat?
"Ozzy?"
There was no reply this time, so she returned to making the tea. There was more activity up and down the stairs, a couple of cardboard boxes carried out. Something else moved from the garage she couldn't quite see. A flash of orange. The old tent. That was all she could think of. The Volvo boot went again. She stood on tiptoe to peer out of the kitchen window. Ozzy was moving more stuff out of the garage. In one hand he had his guitar case and in the other the old leather briefcase that he'd used in his first job when they got married, half their lives ago. He stowed them in the back of the Volvo and slammed the boot down again. Now she had moved from baffled to alarmed. If he had to go back to work, what did he need to take the guitar for? In all the years she had known him, he had never had to rush back into work. That was for the maintenance people, dealing with floods and so on. But he was a new projects manager. Half of it was desk work.
in piddle management, as he liked to say. New sewers, overflow pipes, lots of concrete. In all his long years as a water engineer, his projects had been carefully planned, the schedules laid out over many months. There was none of this seat-of-the-pants stuff that she was seeing now. She poured boiling water from the kettle onto a teabag in the teapot and gave it a quick stir before putting the lid back on. While it brewed, she headed out to the front door and opened it.
"Ozzie, what's going on?"
"A bit of an emergency," he said, staring down at the phone in his hand. "I've got to go now."
He gave her a perfunctory smile. He'd always had a lovely smile. Back in the day when they'd met in Goa, India, she'd been quite taken by the lean, tanned man who had nice teeth, brown eyes and lovely long blonde hair tied back in a ponytail. He still had the nice eyes and good teeth, but only some grey fuzz for hair.
"What about your tea? You've got time for a gulp or two, surely?"
"No, sorry."
"Why are you taking the guitar?"
He stared at her, dumbfounded.
"I saw you carrying it out from the garage."
He stared around the driveway as if there were answers to be found there.
"Tell you later. I'll be back by 6.
As the car slid onto the suburban road, it left an ominous silence behind in the house. In that emptiness grew pain. Through all of their quarter of a century of life together, from the moment she and Ozzie had settled down, Angela had thought she could see where they were heading. A long, straight, predictable pipe, where each section fitted snugly onto the one before, heading to the horizon, their life together safely channeled within. All thanks to his good job. 2 holidays a year and a decent pension at the end of it, now just 4 years away if he took the early retirement option. She'd thought she was happy. Angela was an accommodating woman and a little old-fashioned, but she wasn't a fool. He was gone. He'd said he would be back by 6, but actions speak louder than words. The tent, the guitar, the paperwork. It appeared to her he was leaving for good. He'd been gone less than 5 minutes when the landline rang. She recognised the voice. Kelvin Arrowsmith, regional financial controller at Aqua, she thought. He didn't introduce himself, but simply asked to speak to Ozzie. She told him that he had just gone back into work.
"The Aqua site office or regional HQ?" he asked.
He didn't say. "Is that Kelvin?" she asked.
"Yes."
"Kelvin, honestly, he did seem in a bit of a flap." There was silence at the other end. Then Kelvin said,
"I can't reach him on the mobile. When he calls in, ask him to ring me urgently, however late. Thank you, Angela."
There was the briefest gap between the end of that sentence and Kelvin hanging up, not anywhere near enough for the many questions that Angela wanted to ask. But in that gap, she distinctly heard the sound of Kelvin cursing under his breath. Chapter 2. Ozzie Blanchard soon ran into heavy rain and winter darkness as he left Hemel Hempstead. The Hertfordshire town just northwest of London had been his home for 2 decades. No longer. The die was cast. He wasn't going back. His destination was familiar, but this time the journey was urgent. The next hour would be crucial. Weeks ago he'd sketched out a plan B for this moment. Plan B wasn't detailed because he'd never expected to need it. Plan A should have worked. He hadn't expected to be this scared. The first part of Plan B was that he should take a different route from usual. Minor roads, country lanes, break the routine. His prep hadn't been great. Everything should have been packed and ready. Was he not a professional project manager? But to make the plan in all its detail would have meant considering the worst-case scenario. Ideally, he should have taken his own car, not the company one, but this one had more space and was fueled up. Taking the Ford Focus would have slowed him up and left Angela stuck without wheels. Only one of many ways in which she was destined to be screwed over by his unscheduled departure. He felt guilty, but that was a luxury he couldn't afford. She'd be all right eventually. It was his survival at stake here, not hers. As he drove, he cursed the name again and again. Just one man had put him in this predicament, a greedy, smug bastard, and now his life was at risk. It was gone 5 when Blanchard sat impatiently at a set of roadworks traffic lights, a long queue of rain-smeared taillights visible through the sweeping wipers. A huge four-wheel drive, its lights on full beam, sat right on his tail, gunning the engine impatiently. He could hear the thump of music, too. It brought his enemies to mind and made him nervous. He reset the sat-nav and turned off right onto a minor rural road. As the Volvo splashed through the puddles, Ozzie Blanchard tried to think. Every change of route would cost him time, but unless they had discovered everything, he would still be safe. Or should be. They couldn't have discovered everything, could they? Not yet. Once he arrived at that familiar village, got her into the car and away, they would be safe. Their new life could begin. He rang her on the hands-free, and after 6 rings it went to the message. He whispered, as if being overheard, "It's me. Pick up if you can." An hour later, Blanchard was edging the big Volvo down the cramped, puddled lane of Victorian cottages. Familiar, welcoming, the soft, warm glow of lights from within, families sitting down to an evening meal, a night in front of the TV, reassuring. He edged up outside the house, flecks of rain drifting through the beams of the headlamps. The kitchen light was on, and one upstairs behind curtains. He rang her again, and again left a message. "Come on, it's me, I'm here." Suddenly, headlamps flicked on from a big dark vehicle parked further down the lane, and an engine roared. The door of the cottage opened, and a man he recognised leapt out, running down the garden path towards him. It was a trap. Blanchard jammed his vehicle into reverse, gunned the engine, and leaning over his shoulder, guided the Volvo backwards at high speed up the narrow lane. The big car, a BMW X5, followed him almost nose to nose. The first 30 yards were fine. Then he sideswiped a parked car's wing mirror. At the village green, he reversed straight onto the grass, intending to turn out onto the main road. The BMW blocked his forward route, so Blanchard continued to reverse right over the steps of the war memorial, back down to the footpath, then turned sharp right, smashing down the memorial green rose bushes and into the lane which led down to the dual carriageway. He sped past the Anvil Arms at 60, overtook a van on a blind corner, then headed for the slip road. The big BMW was right behind him. His heart was hammering, and he was taking risks he had never taken before, but he couldn't let them catch him. As he approached the dual carriageway, he could see arc lights in the distance. Once on the slip road, he realised why. There were major roadworks. Traffic was stationary, and he was being fed right into the queue. He was still doing over 60 and had 1 second to make a decision. He flicked the Volvo to the right, crossing the slip road hatch marks. He was headed the wrong way along the dual carriageway exit lane. That sharply curved slip road, designed to slow down exiting traffic, caused his tyres to squeal. He was gambling his life on a single calculation, that this was such a minor turn-off there would be no vehicles coming the other way. He was right. But everything changed the moment he was on the carriageway. A closing speed of 120 miles an hour to oncoming traffic. A large white van swerved out of the way into the fast lane, horn sounding. Blanchard, too, pressed his hand to the horn and kept as far to the right as possible. But this was the start of an overpass across the river way. There was no hard shoulder, just a 1 yard strip to the crash barrier which guarded the drop to the water below. The next 2 vehicles gave him space as he crested the top of the overpass at 60. But 300 yards away, one articulated truck was overtaking another coming up the incline towards him, and there was literally nowhere to go.
The railings ended in 150 yards to be replaced by an embankment and bushes, and he had to get to that spot before the two trucks closed off the gap. Blanchard accelerated and saw the needle flick to 80 as he squeezed the Volvo to the right, one wheel on the grass and one on the edge of the tarmac. The vehicle seemed to leave the ground almost immediately afterwards, and Blanchard had one last glimpse in the mirror. He wasn't being followed any longer. Chapter 3. The Hampshire Constabulary Range Rover arrived within 10 minutes. PC Colin Andrews emerged from the vehicle into the pouring rain while colleagues from other patrol cars closed off the carriageway. He donned Wellingtons and latex gloves and picked up a powerful torch. The beam followed the trail of damage, which included a broken stanchion on a large green road sign, into the undergrowth. No tire marks on the carriageway, perhaps not surprising in the weather. Still, the exit route was straight, which indicated the vehicle had remained under control. No evidence of last-minute braking. Very strange. Almost as if this was intentional. He set off to follow the path of smashed stems and flattened nettles, heading up and over the embankment, then down towards the river. He radioed in his findings, then followed the trail of destruction, steadying himself with a hand on some saplings as he began the muddy descent. There, 50 yards further down in the beam of his torch, was the Volvo, on its roof, in the shallows. The tail lights were still on. With only one hand to guide him, the other holding the light, the steep descent through the wrecked bushes and churned earth was treacherous. Finally, he stumbled through the broken branches of a weeping willow and plunged up to his knees in water. The car lay 10 yards from the edge of the bank, held above the full depth by the felled boughs of trees. Wading across, his wellies now full of water, he shone his beam in through the crazed windscreen and between the inflated airbags. There was no one visible.
"Call out if you can,"
he shouted over the sibilant waters hissing over the stones. There was no reply. The driver's side door was creased inwards, the window frosted and broken, shards of glass curled outwards. He squatted down in the shallows and shone the torch horizontally. There appeared to be no one in the car. At the limits of what he could do without wading waist-deep into the river, he was relieved to hear the sound of approaching sirens. Back up on the bridge, he saw fire appliances, an ambulance and a recovery vehicle, and made his way back to brief them.
"Any casualties?" asked the burly fire chief who greeted him.
"Not that I can see," Andrews replied. "Wriggled out somehow through the driver's side window. Miraculous, really. Probably a drugged-up joyrider. Who else goes the wrong way up a dual carriageway?"
The next day. D.I. Helen Kaplan of Hampshire Constabulary rang the doorbell at 14 Witcherley Crescent, Hemel Hempstead. The woman who came to the door was a trim 50-something with silvery hair. Kaplan introduced herself to Angela Blanchard.
"Any news on the search?"
Angela asked, showing the detective into the lounge. A long-haired cat was lying splayed out in the middle of a white leatherette settee, leaving the women to sit on the other two components of the three-piece suite.
"Nothing so far. We think he got out of the car. We traced the signal on his work mobile phone moving for about 5 minutes afterwards until it ceased. I take it you've not had any phone calls?"
"No, I would have let you know if I had. Why wouldn't he ring me?"
"Well, the phone may not have been usable, even though it was giving out a signal," Kaplan said.
She kept from Mrs. Blanchard the news that the phone had been used to call another mobile phone nearby, an unregistered one, in the minutes after the crash. Such news was likely to be an unwelcome addition to the shock of hearing her husband had been in an accident.
"He might have been injured," Angela said.
"Yes, that's quite possible," Kaplan said. "Suffering from shock, at least. Disorientated. He may even have lost his memory."
The detective got out her notebook.
"Now, Mrs. Blanchard, I understand you told the PC who first visited that your husband had been behaving strangely."
"That's right. He was clearly in a flap and in a hurry to get out again. It's so unlike him. His work isn't like that, with last-minute changes of plan. He's a project manager, and these projects are measured in months, if not years."
"So Do you think it's possible that he was just giving an excuse and it wasn't about work?
Yes. He took personal things with him, like his guitar and an old tent. I thought he might be leaving me.
Her eyes welled up.
But then I got a phone call from his boss, who did seem to be pretty anxious to get in touch with him, so I then thought maybe it was about work.
Kaplan made detailed notes. I'll be speaking to Aqua Weston later on. As she left, she thought this was unlike any other disappearance she had covered. Fleeing from an old life, yes. But urgently enough to head off into a new one the wrong way on a major road and end up upside down in a river. And then gone. Vanished. Chapter 4. 6 months later. Wednesday. Detective Chief Inspector Craig Gillard had visited most parts of Surrey in his decades in the police, but the tiny hamlet of Rissington Common was new to him. A body had been found there by workmen, close to the River Wey. Right in the southwest corner of the county, the map had shown a thorn-shaped valley sticking painfully into the top edge of Hampshire. On this showery morning, he'd taken the A286 past Hazelmere and then the new dual carriageway from Camelsdale heading towards the A272. Once off this elevated link road, he followed the signs and the road soon narrowed and deteriorated, overshadowed on both sides by dense woodland. After a few hundred yards, a mildewed sign announced his arrival at Rissington Common. A small triangular green divided the hamlet between a whitewashed pub on the left and a village shop on the right. The few dozen cottages he could see were all Victorian, and there were few of the signs of gentrification that the rest of the county had in spades. It was only 4 miles from Liphook and Hazelmere, but it could have been 1,000. Gillard eased his unmarked grey Vauxhall along Bourne Lane past a large and untidy builder's yard and a dozen more cottages. The road deteriorated further as he headed downhill towards the river, becoming a potholed track crammed with untidily parked vehicles. There were fewer homes and cars in the final 200 yards. The last house on the right was a large rectory type with a wild garden, and on the left was a tiny stone church with a squat tower and overgrown graveyard. Beyond it, the land opened up as marshy pasture, grazed by scraggy cattle and dotted with alder, silver birch and stands of willow. In the distance to the left, Gillard could see the upraised orange arm of a tracked digger and the flash of blue lights, his destination. The Vauxhall bumped and ground along the heavily rutted track until a dead end at some bollards and swung left through an open metal gate, avoiding the two deep muddy trenches left by the crane's tracks. The detective gingerly steered the car across the meadow following tyre marks and then mounted a new crushed stone track which led up through a dense stand of willows to an embankment at the river's edge. The 22-ton tracked JCB excavator atop the embankment dominated the scene. Below it, near the water's edge, were two Water Company four-wheel drives and a police patrol Range Rover. A group of a dozen face-masked individuals, three of them police, congregated around the water's edge between the stumps of two trees, staring into a large, water-filled hole. Gillard got out of the car and went to the boot. He pulled on a Tyvek coverall and a pair of Wellingtons, donned a pair of blue latex gloves and a face mask and made his way down the embankment to join them. As he approached, three uniformed male officers turned to greet him. Of the rest, four were wearing Water Company high-vis in lime green, and one who seemed to be in charge was a short, dapper man wearing a suit and a hard hat. The detective introduced himself.
"Kelvin Arrowsmith, Regional Financial Controller for Aqua Weston," he responded, bumping elbows with Gillard.
"They've just found human remains,"
blurted out one of the uniforms, a fresh-faced PC in his early 20s. "So I was told. Down here?" Gillard asked, crouching down to look into the hole. He could see something grey and slimy in the cloudy water. The smell wasn't too bad, considering, like old cheese rather than rotting flesh.
"Only part of it," said one of the contractors, a shortish but solid guy with a gingery crew cut, who introduced himself as Aidan Tickett. "Most of it's still in the bucket." He gestured towards the excavator with a thumb over his shoulder. Some of it got crushed. Gillard and Aidan made their way over to the huge metal bucket of the excavator. Amongst huge clods of clay were more grey, slimy lumps and pieces of what could be bone. Torn fragments of black plastic were in there too, along with soggy residue which had the look of textiles. The cheesy stink was stronger here. "It's a mess, isn't it?" the contractor said. "It's often the way," Gillard said. "Who was operating the excavator and who else was here when it was found?" Aidan scratched his nose with a grubby finger. "Female apprentice, first week on the JS-220. She was upset, so we sent her home. Trev Collier, the engineer from Aqua, witnessed it. I came down a bit later." Aidan pointed out Collier. He was one of the hard hats, a lean man in his 50s with a deeply lined face that spoke of decades of outdoor work. Gillard took Collier aside and made notes as the engineer described how the JCB's bucket had dug into part of the riverbank and lifted soil and roots further back to make a higher embankment. "That's when I saw body parts," Collier said. "I've been in this business 20 years and we've found all sorts of historical stuff, but I've never seen a dead body before. The woman working the JCB was freaked out when I told her. She thought it was her fault for not spotting it, but I told her that it could have happened to anybody." The detective peered downriver where the watercourse widened into a broad meander that led into tangled woodland under the Link Road overpass. "So, what is the project you're working on?" Collier sighed. "We've been trying to stop sewer overflow into the river with some bigger pipes and a protective embankment. It's a joint operation with the Environment Agency. It actually should have been done when the Link Road was put in," he said, pointing half a mile downriver past Bourne Lane where Gillard had driven in. "You'll have to stop work until CSI has finished, and that could take a while," Gillard said. The sound of vehicles arriving made them both look up. Two CSI vans were making their way carefully across the marshy meadow and pulled up next to Gillard's car. They were followed by a Hampshire Constabulary patrol car. Gillard smiled to himself. The county boundary ran right through Rissington Common, so he wasn't surprised that Hampshire was showing an interest in a Surrey case. A male uniform emerged, followed by a fit-looking woman in her late 40s, wearing a grey trouser suit and mask, who immediately began speaking to the CSI team. "Oh no," Gillard thought. "It's her. Just my luck." Detective Chief Superintendent Stella Anderson made her way across the muddy meadow and up the embankment towards Gillard. Her hair was quite different from the long ponytail he had known. Now it was silvery blonde, shorter and shaped, with highlights. It suited her. She held out her arms for balance as she picked where to put her feet amongst the sloppy cowpats and rutted mud behind the striding uniformed officer. Unexpectedly needing Wellingtons was always a danger for detectives, particularly when you didn't bring your own vehicle but had hitched a ride in a patrol car. That showed some inexperience. Gillard couldn't help noticing that she'd already got muddy splashes at the bottom of her trousers and on her highly polished black shoes. His mask hid an uncharitable smile.
"Craig, how are you?" she asked. "It's been a long time."
"I'm fine, ma'am," he replied. "I'd heard that you were in the Hampshire force." Stella, then under her maiden name Taylor, had trained with him years ago in the Met Police and was quickly promoted to sergeant when they were both in uniform. She was smart, perceptive and adventurous, having hiked the entire Andes from Colombia to Tierra del Fuego when she was 23. They had worked together happily for 3 months and become friends, until an unexpected Friday evening and night in a Basildon hotel after a training course, which in the morning felt more than a little awkward. She cut contact with him soon after, and a few months later left the police. At the time, he had no idea what he had done wrong, although in those days his behaviour with women had often been cavalier. It had taken him years and the prodding of some of his remaining female friends to realise that. He probably owed Stella an apology. And here she was, back in the force, and senior to him.
"I was recruited 3 years ago. I normally specialise in fraud, given that I've been working in forensic accountancy in the intervening years,"
Ah, that's why, then. He had wondered why she had been parachuted back in at such a senior level. There was a well-established level of resentment amongst detectives working their way up through the ranks at those who got brought in without having to pass the exams, or suffer the tedium of day-to-day work such as checking CCTV and the car licensing databases.
So, this is a little outside your bailiwick, Gillard said, indicating the excavator behind him.
Don't worry, Craig, I'm not planning to pinch the case from you. I'm just curious about what you found.
Her smile was the same broad grin he had found attractive all those years ago. Her eyes were hazel with just the traces of laughter lines.
So am I.
Knowing her sharp mind, Gillard felt that this would be anything but idle curiosity. He led her around, first to the watery hole and then to the digger's bucket, while the CSI team were marking up posts from which to hang blue and white crime scene tape.
"I'll happily keep you in the loop for any developments, ma'am," he said.
"Yes, please," she said crisply, glancing down at her spattered shoes. "When there's a positive ID."
"Not much call for wellies in fraud, is there?" Gillard said, following her gaze. She smiled again.
"I'm not so sure. There's nothing muddier than dodgy accounts. So just blind copy me in on everything you find, okay?"
She began to make her way back, watched by the various contractors.
"Is that your boss?" asked Aidan, leaning on his spade.
"Thankfully, no," Gillard said. "We're Surrey, she's Hampshire."
"Territorial like magpies, is it?"
He looked amused.
"More like reverse territorial. Given the current resource problems we have, every force tries to dump work on its neighbour, especially when it's arguable which side of the border the crime scene is on."
"I've seen her before," he said, "poking about in the village a few months ago. Asking questions in the pub."
"What kind of questions?"
"About the missing water guys, I recall," he said.
"Ozzie Blanchard?"
Trevor Collier had mentioned to Gillard that his predecessor as regional surveyor had crashed a company car in the area 6 months ago and then disappeared.
"That's him. It was just before a lockdown began and it was so obvious she was a cop."
"Do tell," Gillard asked, intrigued. Aidan's eyes lit up.
"Something watchful about her, like she couldn't relax. I was sitting at a table with my brother and she was at the bar and clearly didn't know anybody. I called Guy, the manager, over and asked what she was drinking and he told me soda water. So I asked him to get her in a vodka and soda on me."
"Did he tell her what was in it?"
"I don't know, but he did say it was from me. I saw her stare at me in the mirror behind the bar and take a careful sniff of the drink. Very wary she was.
Professional, perhaps.
No doubt. She didn't drink it except a little sip. Ordered another soda water, switched the glasses when she thought I didn't see and drank that."
"What else did you learn from her?" Gillard asked. It was a rare treat to be offered an insight into undercover policing from the other side. The other guy knew it too and was enjoying telling the tale.
"Guy told me that she had described herself as a saleswoman, but I never believed it," Aidan said.
Gillard wondered quite why this construction worker would care so much.
"Anyway, it's all above my pay grade," Aidan said. "I just dig holes for a living and keep my head down."
Gillard nodded towards the digger.
"So, have you any idea whose body this may be? Ever lost a member of the crew?"
"No, not one of ours."
He shoved his hands in his pockets and gave a little smile as if there was a joke Gillard wasn't getting. He followed Aidan's gaze towards an animated conversation between the two water company officials. They were maybe 40 yards away, but it was clear that Arrowsmith, the smaller but more senior of the two, was berating Collier for something.
"Not one of ours," Aidan had said, "but maybe one of theirs. The missing Ozzie Blanchard, perhaps."
Gillard left the CSI crew and the uniforms to do their job. It was fairly clear from the poor condition of the body that this was not going to be an easy ID job. Dr. David Delahaye, the Home Office forensic pathologist, would be down in an hour, but Gillard wasn't expecting too much. Purely based on the photos Craig had emailed him, Delahaye had warned that it was likely that he couldn't shed much light on cause of death and suggested that it would be good to get not only a forensic archaeologist, but the county archaeologist too, who could give some clues as to whether this was a historical death.
The detective had already taken a quick look through missing persons for the local area. How big a task it was depended on how far into the past you wanted to go and how large an area you wanted to use. There was the infamous unsolved case of Sally Witchins, a 10-year-old girl missing since 2005 in Winchester, 32 miles west. Of those old enough to have chosen to disappear, there were probably 30 within a 50-mile radius since 2000. Like most mispers, there often seemed a family reason. Arguments, divorce, bereavement. Many of them were originally from other areas of the UK, three of them foreign nationals. There was nothing that really stood out. Gillard walked back to his car and changed out of his Wellingtons. He then drove back across the meadow and up into the village, which, unlike the river valley, was in Hampshire. Parking outside the Anvil Arms, he looked longingly at the faded blackboard which advertised real ales and home-cooked food. Clipped to the blackboard was a plasticised menu listing a mouth-watering array of dishes under the heading Hampshire Young Chef of the Year. The pandemic lockdown was 4 months old and due to end the coming weekend. Like many, he was nostalgic for the pre-COVID world. He gelled his hands, refixed his face mask, and emerged from the car. The weather was genial, so he took a 5-minute stroll through the village. One shop, formerly a post office. Forge Cottage nearby, a nod towards the blacksmiths it presumably used to be. The distant rumble of the Link Road reminded him how Rissington Common, probably always an obscure hamlet, was now totally off the beaten track. It wasn't on the way from anywhere to anywhere else. Even to get to Upper Rissington, you now had to go back almost to the main road and drive under the flyover. A short but broad young man in his 20s emerged from a cottage 2 doors down from the pub and laboriously fixed a mask over his nose and mouth. He had the characteristic features of Down syndrome and was towing a skinny dog. On spotting Gillard, he approached.
"Hello. Did you hear about the dead body down by the Willows?"
he asked. "I did, and I'm here to investigate."
"Are you a policeman?"
"Yes, I'm a detective. My name is Craig Gillard."
"I'm Stewie, and this is Sprocket,"
he said, pointing at the dog, which had the long, melancholy face of a whippet. "Glad to meet you, Stewie." "Hello, Sprocket," Gillard said.
"My mum is Sheila. She has gone to the shops. What's your favourite game? Mine is Cluedo."
"I used to be a Monopoly fan years ago." "So, what do you know about this body?" Stevie winced.
"It was all broken. Nasty. Was it a man or a lady?"
"We're not sure yet."
"Was it murder? With the lead piping in the library?"
Gillard couldn't suppress a smile behind his mask at the Cluedo reference. "We really don't know, Stewie. It may take a long time to find out."
"I like Miss Scarlet, but the murderer is always the vicar."
He nodded.
"Mum is very good at the game."
"The Rev Green, if I remember rightly." Gillard remembered a few of the characters of the game, which he hadn't played for decades. Stewie shook his head.
"The Rev Cleaver. He's a bad man."
He looked over Gillard's shoulder as if worried about being overheard. "Did somebody tell you this?" Gillard asked.
"Don't tell tales," Stewie said, shaking his head emphatically. "Mum says don't tell tales. Goodbye."
He tugged the dog, which followed reluctantly as Stewie walked up the street.
"Come on, Sprocket."
The dog looked over its shoulder and gave Gillard a reproachful stare. Gillard made his way down to the builder's yard, which according to the sign belonged to CJT Contracting, brackets Hants Limited. There was also a shipping container labelled Buckingham Pallets Limited, besides which hundreds of wooden pallets were stacked. Someone clearly had a sense of humour. Behind the padlocked gates and wire mesh fence paced a couple of Doberman guard dogs, their cropped ears giving them a devilish appearance. Gillard recalled reading in some police briefing paper that it was no longer legal to crop ears in this way. Behind them were a couple of old porter cabins, 3 or 4 caravans, a brand new long wheelbase transit, and a collection of older flatbed trucks. Further back in a weed-strewn paddock were half a dozen elderly diggers and excavators. As he watched, a dark blue BMW X5 pulled out from a driveway adjacent to the yard with a thick-set, silver-haired man at the wheel. He gave Gillard a hard stare as he drove off. The detective memorised the number plate and entered it in his notebook as he headed back to his car. Once inside, he took out his iPad and looked up the directors of the building firm from company's house. The managing director was Mr. C.J. Tickett, and there were several other Ticketts on the director's list, including Aidan, the man he'd talked to. Not just a hole digger, then. Something about the unusual surname triggered a vague memory. A Google search brought up the name of an aspiring middleweight boxer, Rory Typhoon Tickett, who'd done quite well for several years until being knocked unconscious by Ukrainian Denis Lazarenko in 2016. There were few mentions of him in the last 4 years. Gillard, no fan of boxing, didn't think this was what he had remembered. He delved further into the search results and found a few articles from the 1980s about a Hampshire man being sentenced for murder. There it was, Christopher John Tickett of Bourne Lane, Rissington Common, the same address. Tickett had been 31 when he had been sentenced to 17 years for killing a neighbour, Henry Willow, in 1982. Tickett would now be 69. That could well have been him in the car. Interesting that a dead body should be found so close by. Gillard closed up the device and drove off to Hazelmere. He had some research to do. Hazelmere was a well-to-do Surrey town, and Gillard knew there would be no difficulty finding what he was looking for. He parked the Vauxhall by a parade of shops outside a row of three estate agents. He asked the same questions in each, but it was only on the third that he got the comprehensive answer he was looking for. "Rissington Common," answered the middle-aged suit, barely able to restrain his surprise. "And are you looking to buy or rent?" "Buy," Gillard said. He passed on some bogus details about his budget before asking what there was in the area. "We've got some very nice places in Upper Rissington, still within your price bracket. That's a very up-and-coming area." He tapped a ballpoint pen at his screen. "But Rissington Common? Do you have connections there? Is that why you're interested?" The man asked Gillard to take a seat, and he did. "No, it just looks nicely out of the way." The estate agent's woolly eyebrows shot almost to the top of his head. "Well, it certainly is that, sir. And I have to admit, you do get a lot for your money." He stood and turned to a filing cabinet, reached right to the back, and brought out a handful of dog-eared property listings. "We've got three or four cottages with plenty of scope for modernisation, the sort of character projects you could really put your thumbprint on. How many bedrooms are you looking for?"
"At least a couple, but I have heard stories about bad sewers and so forth."
The estate agent sat down and appraised Gillard.
"Indeed, and you will appreciate that's why you get so much for your money."
"So what exactly is the story?"
"Well, all the land around there is on the floodplain, which used not to be a problem until the 2009 floods. Unfortunately, there was also a sewer bottleneck there, supposedly fixed a year ago. There had been quite a few instances of discharges into the river during heavy rainfall. I'm not aware that many of the houses themselves have been flooded with it, but getting buildings insurance for many of those properties is difficult. Planning permission isn't straightforward either because the land is designated as contaminated."
"That's difficult for the inhabitants."
The estate agent steepled his fingers.
"Absolutely. And that's why I would thoroughly recommend Upper Rissington. Got a lovely Victorian semi just come on the market. No chain, beautiful aspect, absolute bargain in my view."
Gillard let the man pass across the property sheet, and after giving a bogus email address and mobile number, returned to the car. Chapter 5. By the time Gillard got back to the crime scene, Dr. David Delahaye was already there. Gillard saw his Tesla parked at the bottom of the lane and spotted the balding dome of the Home Office forensic consultant as he was talking to a couple of others within the blue tape at the crime scene. Delahaye looked up as Gillard made his way through the increasingly muddy meadow that led to the water's edge. He was standing with a tall, wild-haired man in his 60s with a bushy beard and thick spectacles.
"May I introduce Dr. Clive Hancock, Surrey County Archaeologist?" Delahaye said.
Gillard touched elbows with them both.
"I remember you, Clive, from the Forest Bridge clay pit killings. I was only a DC then."
Hancock scratched his head.
"That was a long time ago."
"If I remember rightly, it was 1996, Gillard said. They continued chatting as Delahaye led them towards the bucket of the excavator, about chest high.
"So, what we seem to have is head and upper body here, mostly, anyway, and parts of the lower limbs still in the hole over there."
He pointed back towards the muddy pit by the river.
"Now, there's been serious damage to the corpse, some of which was clearly caused by the current excavation. We're missing the entire lower mandible and many upper teeth, plus two fingers on the left hand."
He turned to Gillard and smiled.
"I must say it's absolutely delightful at my age to be able to get a close look at a body in situ without bending down." "I'll second that," said Hancock.
"So, is this a piece of history, or could we be looking at a modern crime?" Gillard asked.
"Or perhaps a historic crime," Hancock said.
Delahaye began.
"First impressions are that we are seeing almost complete putrefaction. In these anaerobic conditions, the flesh becomes adipocere, a kind of waxy soap-type substance. Not good news, because adipocere doesn't hold DNA. Generally, we'd be talking about an absolute minimum of 3 months in exactly the right conditions to get to this stage. The aroma of cheese is quite indicative. However, it's not all bad news. Modernity is indicated by the presence of an amalgam filling and the fact that it's just in jeans and scraps of a shirt. From the plastic tatters, it is possible he may have been buried in a bin bag."
Hancock took up the story.
"I agree with that. In any case, we're not talking about some ancient burial site, because the soil here along the water's edge has already been disturbed as recently as the 1990s because of work by both the Environment Agency and the Water Company."
Delahaye nodded.
"I'd say there's fairly strong evidence that we're talking about someone who's been here less than 50 years.
He reached into the bucket and with a pencil pointed at several jagged splinters an inch or two long, plus some smaller pieces.
"Is that glass or ceramic?" Gillard asked.
"Plastic, from a ballpoint pen," Delahaye said. "They were nearby, rather than on the corpse, so we can't be sure they were his."
Gillard nodded. "It makes it difficult, given how much disturbance of his last resting place has occurred." He inclined his head back towards the excavator.
"For forensic purposes, I'm going to assume this is a crime, so I'll let CSI examine the entire area and bring out the body, or as much of it as we can find. It's a long shot, but I'd like to see if we can get any DNA from the biro fragments, if we can't get any from the body. In the meantime, it would help if you would both stay around to spot anything CSI might miss."
They agreed. Gillard stepped away to answer messages left by his boss, Detective Chief Superintendent Brian Radar Dobbs. The DCS, who'd got his nickname from his prominent ears, was a 30-year veteran of policing and had spent his early years as a detective in Hong Kong. More recently, he had an acquired reputation as a bit of a paper pusher, and this, together with bouts of severe depression, meant he was rarely seen outside Surrey's police headquarters at Mount Brown in Guildford. However, since Gillard had been pulled from a high-profile case early in the year, Dobbs had been tasked by Chief Constable Alison Rigby with more closely supervising him. In practice, this involved second-guessing almost every conclusion Gillard came to, making him nostalgic for the days when Dobbs was off sick and he had almost complete operational independence. Terse message returned, Gillard made his way back to the car and left the experts to it. He sat there for a few minutes, checking his messages. The Environment Agency and the water company Aqua Western Limited had sent him the requested maps of data and times of work commissioned in the immediate area. Glancing at them, it didn't immediately help establish how recently the soil at the riverbank had been disturbed. No doubt the archaeologist could make more sense of them. A tap at the window made him look up. An unmasked, distinguished-looking woman in her early 70s with neat, silvery hair was looking in at him. He buzzed down the window.
Excuse me, are you with Aqua Western?
She asked. No, Surrey Police. He hurriedly put his mask back on, but the woman showed no signs of stepping away.
Oh, is that about the body?
Yes, I'm afraid I can't tell you very much.
It could be an Anglo-Saxon burial site. There are quite a lot of them around here. Of course, it could also be that fellow who drove his car off the bridge back in the winter.
Are you referring to Ossie Blanchard?
Yes. Yeah, everyone thought he survived because there was no body found in the car, but it could be him, couldn't it? Seeing as he used to work for this lot.
She indicated the construction site with a thumb. You mean Aqua Western?
Yes. I crossed swords with the man on numerous occasions. Slippery fellow though he was, I preferred him to the new one, Collier, who is just plain obstructive.
Gillard made a mental note to look into the relationship between the village community and the water company.
My name is Sheila Ransom, she said,
offering a delicate hand through the window. Gillard leaned back and offered his elbow in exchange, which she squeezed in an overly familiar fashion. I've just met Stewie, Gillard said. She beamed.
He's everyone's friend.
Lovely man. I hear you're a bit of a demon at Cluedo.
He's obsessed with the game, she said with a smile. He'd play it all day, every day if he could. He's 31 now, and I worry what will happen to him after I'm gone.
I'm sure that won't be for many years. She peered into the distance.
And I've got plenty to keep me occupied in the meantime. I'm leading the legal campaign to bring Aqua Western to book over all the pollution here. It's made our lives a misery, and we can't sell our homes.
I'd heard something about that, he said. Perhaps you'd be good enough to stand back a little, in the interests of social distancing. She moved back, but soon closed in again.
I've spent years accumulating legal ammunition against them. I'm happy to share my evidence.
That would be a civil matter, I'm afraid. I know it must be frustrating, but the police really can't get involved.
No, that's not true. I have incontrovertible evidence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.